We didn't go into enough detail about what it is we're trying to optimize here. I just said something vague like we want to maximize the sum of our reward. Well, it's not so simple. In fact, here's a great story to illustrate that. There's a great Russian comedian, Yakov Smirnov. You may remember him or not, but he told this joke once that I really loved. He said, have you heard about the Soviet lottery? It's 1 million rubles if you win. 1 ruble a year for 1 million years. So the point is, and if you recall from one of our earlier lessons, that $1 or 1 ruble delivered to us 1 million years in the future is really not as valuable as a dollar or ruble that we get now. And so, for instance, if we think about our robot living forever, it might do something just mundane to gather a dollar a year. That's an infinite amount of money, but in practice, it doesn't really work that well. So to consider that and illustrate that, I'm going to show you a little maze problem here, and we'll think about what the robot ought to do that would be optimal in this maze. So here's our robot, and here's the challenge for our robot. We have a reward here of $1 and a reward over here of $1 million. So if the robot comes over here and gets this $1, it's special in that each time he touches it, he gets the dollar and it goes away, but then it comes back. So the robot could come here and go back and forth and get a dollar each time it moves here. This one, once the robot tags it, it's gone. But clearly it's worthwhile to come over here and grab it. Now this red area is obstacle, it can't go there. And here I wrote some rewards that the robot, and in fact negative one is a penalty, but the penalties the robot would get as it went this way, and zero penalty that way. Now if we say that what we want to optimize is the sum of all future rewards, then it doesn't matter whether we go this way and just get that dollar over and over and over again, or if we go this way, get the $1 million, come back, and then that get that $1 over and over and over again. There's no difference because they both sum to infinity over time. Now, what if we say, okay, I want to optimize my reward over 3 moves. So I've got a finite horizon. Let's consider the rewards we'd get with a finite horizon of 3 if we go this way versus this way. So if we go this way, we're going to get rewards of -1, -1, -1. And if we go this way, we get $0, $1. And then we have to move down here and get another 0. So clearly, starting here with a finite horizon of 3, the best thing to do is go up there. Now, if we extend the horizon a little bit further, say out to 8, we would find that this is the best thing to do. So if we go this way, we get -1, -1, -1, until we hit the jackpot here and get 1 million. Clearly, if you sum this up, it's a pretty good prize. If we go this way and touch that $1 over and over again, we get this. So clearly, as we expand our finite horizon, trivially out to, say, 8 steps, going this way and tagging that 1 million is the best thing to do. If we carried it even further, we'd discover that then we should come back this way and go to that dollar and tag it over and over and over again. Let me formalize these a little bit. With the infinite horizon, what we're trying to maximize is the sum of all rewards over all of the future. So it's the sum of each of these rewards for I equals 1 to infinity. The finite horizon is very similar, it's just we don't go to infinity. So if we're optimizing over a horizon of 4 steps, n would be 4, we're just trying to maximize the sum of the reward for the next 4 steps. Now, there is yet another formulation that if you think back to that lecture a while back about what's the value of a future dollar, we can dig that up and it makes a lot of sense in terms of reinforcement learning. So remember that if it takes us, say, 4 years to get a dollar, that dollar is less valuable than, say, if it takes 1 year. And in the same way, if it takes, say, 8 steps to make a dollar, that dollar is less valuable than a dollar I can get just in 1 step. And the way we represent that is very simple, just like we represented the sum of future dividends, and it looks like this. It's called discounted reward. So instead of just summing up the R sub i's, we multiply it by this factor gamma to the I minus 1, such that our immediate reward, the very next one we get, whatever gamma is, when it gets raised to the zeroth power, it's just 1. So that means for our very next step, we get R. But for the step after it, it's gamma to the 1, so it devalues that reward a little bit. Gamma is a value between 0 and 1. The closer it is to 1, the more we value rewards in the future. The closer it is to 0, the less we value rewards in the future. In fact, if gamma is set equal to 1, this is exactly the same as the infinite horizon. But gamma relates very strongly to interest rates, if you recall. So if, say, gamma were 0.95, it means each step in the future is worth about 5% less than the immediate reward if we got it right away. This is the method that we use in Q-learning. One reason is that the math turns out to be very handy, and it provides nice convergence properties.